aortic regurgitation. What is the etiology? If the root of aorta got dilated, then the aortic valvular annulus also get dilated and regurgitation will occur. Right? It can be idiopathic. In elderly people who are having hypertension, which comes with age, aortic root can dilate and precipitate regurgitation. Collagen vascular disorders can lead to development of aortic regurgitation. In rheumatology, we are going to discuss a lot of collagen vascular disorders. My friends, there is a myxomatous degeneration of the elastin in the media of root of aorta, which lead to development of aortic root dilatation. Similarly, rheumatic heart disease, endocarditis, anything can lead to. So what is the main culprit, doctor? If you do typically aortic angiogram, a dilated root of aorta is a very important feature. This is an example of aortic dissection, which also can lead to aortic regurgitation. Suppose if it is involving ascending aorta, aortic dissection. What is aortic dissection? Blood will dissect into the aortic wall and try to keep breaking it, and like a zip is opened, it will be traveling through the wall. Then that can increase the aortic root diameter and can lead to development of aortic regurgitation. Any regurgitation, how will you recognize? Rangoli dalte, color doppler mein. Blue color hai ya red color hai ya mixing hai. Agar mixing hai to seedha jane wale khoon aur reverse mein aane wale khoon dono clash ho rahe. Regurgitant and straightforward blood. So typically between aorta and left ventricle, if you take the forward flowing left ventricular blood and reverse coming aortic blood, they both will be leading to typical regurgitation when you do the either MR or AR anything. So what valvular abnormalities can lead to AR, doctor? Endocarditis, aortic root dilatation, or a nodular rheumatic disease. Did we include bicuspid aortic valve in this? No. Bicuspid aortic valve is more likely to lead to aortic stenosis, is what you need to appreciate. So what lead to proximal aortic root dilatation? First pathology we are talking about, proximal aortic root dilatation. Syphilis, hypertension, of course after the advent of HIV, big brother, syphilis, younger brother, has taken a backstage. But if I remember, all aortic regurgitation I learnt as a fourth year MBBS student is one Viraya was our syphilitic patient. He used to have the tuck, 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 all hard sounds he himself used to show. Aortic area in all the areas. So he is the best cardiology teacher I had to learn aortic regurgitation. Syphilitic aortic regurgitation patient. So, but once upon a time when syphilis was more rampant, there was a lutic degeneration. Lutic degeneration of the aortic root. Hypertension, Ehlers-Danlos, Turner syndrome. And in third trimester of pregnancy also, there is a predisposition for the proximal aortic root dilatation and can precipitate a aortic regurgitation, is what need to be remembered. So this is the classical appearance, doctor. You have a normal aortic valve. You can have a bicuspid aortic valve. This third cusp is not there, but generally that lead to aortic stenosis. Now, Marfan's is an entity you need to remember in AR, because it can lead to proximal aortic root dilatation and precipitate aortic regurgitation. So how will a patient of AR will present, doctor? Who the LV got liquidated. LV is bankrupt hemodynamically, because it worked its last until last breath to pump all that regurgitant blood also. But so much regurgitation that it said I can't do anymore, and it got dilated and failed. So all LV failure signs. What are LV failure signs? PND, orthopnea and dyspnea. Now I like to ask you, S3, S4. S3, S4. Between the two, which one do you expect in aortic stenosis? Between S3 and S4.
Come on, we already discussed. Let us ask our online students. Kunal, Rajni, Sirisha, Prasad, Reshma, anybody can answer. Between S3, S4, which is seen in case of the aortic stenosis, doctor? S3, you mean S3? Already we told the doctor, sign of left ventricular failure is S3. Sign of left ventricular non-compliance is S4. But S3 and S4 together happen in ventricular systole or diastole? During which phase? Ventricular diastole only. S3 and S4, both of them occur in ventricular diastole only. So, very good. Prasad says S3, Sirisha says S4. When you are students of Dr. Murali Bharadwaj, how can confusion can happen on S3, S4? Chalo, aur ek bar bolenge. Those who already understood concept, excuse me, I am an obsessive compulsive neurotic teacher. I can't help if you are answering wrong. Simple doctor, LV failed. It is unable to pump the blood into root of aorta. So blood remained in LV at the end of systole because it failed and unable to pump. Right? Now, LV is now undergoing diastole. From atrium, blood is jumping into left ventricle. Left atrium, it is jumping into left ventricle. Where is it jumping into? Into an empty left ventricle or into a left ventricle in which some stagnant blood is there at the end of the systole. So, that lead to splash and that splash is called S3. Khatam? If LV fails, blood stagnates at the end of systole. If it stagnates, when the left ventricle is undergoing diastole, blood jumps into the stagnant pool of blood. And that leads to splash, which is called S3. Hence, S3 is called ventricular gallop, is what need to be remembered. Now, when is this occurring? Early part of diastole or late part of diastole? When do you call diastole? Between S1, S2 or S2, S1? Between S2 and S1, you call ventricular diastole. So, after S2 is over, in the early part of ventricular diastole, when the left atrial blood jumps like a first year MBBS student into medical college, it discovered that lot of seniors have failed in their exams and their concepts are zero. And it's a failing batches before me. It makes a huge sound. What is it called? S3. Got it? Then, late part of ventricular diastole may atrium contracts and pushes the blood into ventricle. If it is a hypertrophied non-compliant ventricle, what will left atrium has to do? It has to use more force to contract. Hence, the sound you listen is called S4. And when is it occurring? That is also occurring when the ventricle is undergoing diastole from atrium, it is receiving blood, but during the late part of the ventricular diastole. Diastole means what has already happened and what is not about to happen. S2 has already happened, S1 is about to happen between S2 and S1. So after S2, if the left ventricle failed, you listen S3. If the left ventricle is hypertrophic, you listen S4. And after that, aortic valve closes. And ventricular diastole is over, hence you listen S1, and once more S2 is heard. So, like a parrot, you must remember S1, S2. Then, when will you listen opening snap of mitral stenosis? Mitral stenosis, opening snap. Is it diastolic event or systolic event? When ventricle is undergoing diastole only, you listen it. Hence, where you expect it to stay? OAS. Between S1, S2, or S2 and S1? Between S2 and S1, hence we call S2 ke baad OS, OS ke baad if the LV failure is there, then it won't be there if it is pure MS. But anyway, to complete the list, S2 ke baad OS, OS ke, saath S3, agar LV fail hoye to, agar LV hypertrophic hai to S4, then comes the S1, then comes the S2. Right, doctor? Right. Simple. Right. So, that's right. Please help her. Suprita is unable to view the live class. Please ask Rajni or somebody to help Suprita. How, why she is, ask her them to call and help her out. Yeah, please come. So that is the story, doctor. Got it? Before exam also, you, if you didn't understand, give me a ring. I'll be more than happy to explain you what you didn't understand. No way that you can't understand and go home. Right? So now, dyspnea, orthopnea, PND, anything can be there. Just like in AS, even in AR, angina can be there, because if there is a regurgitation, sufficient pressure doesn't build in the root of aorta. Unless it is built, coronaries won't be perfused. So that's the reason angina can be there. LV failure will be there. Wide pulse pressure but not narrow pulse pressure, because of the hyperdynamic circulation. Then there is a pistol shot femorals. Put your step on the femoral, you listen. Have you any time gone for vacation and played with the pistol shot in the mall? So, tuck, tuck, tuck those pistol shots. Like sound. Once more, why pistol shot sound? All that hyperdynamic circulation will lead to pistol shot sounds. Then hold the radial pulse and raise it. It collapses. Bounding, but when you are feeling it, how will be the pulse? It won't be AS wala pulse. AS wala pulse kaise rehta? Like a lazy guy removing the pant. Slow raising. But aortic regurgitation is like emergency coitus in the lift kind of thing. Bounding pulse. Fast. Tuck, 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 tuck. It will be like a bounding pulse. Right? And if you raise the pulse, raise the hand of the patient, what will happen? Typically, collapse of the pulse will be there. It is a very important thing called Corrigan's pulse is what need to be basically remembered. Then, pulsus bisferiens is what you need to see. What you will basically see with two palpable waves in the systole. Why does this basically happen? First ventricle will pump the blood into aorta, then regurgitation occurs, so there is a drop in pressure and once more there is a rise in pressure. So bisferiens pulse with two palpable systolic waves is what you need to remember. Then Derosier's sign in aortic regurgitation. Whenever you feel the femoral artery, during the diastole, there is a femoral bruit. If you happen to compress, that is basically called, if you compress with the stent, that is called Derosier's sign. Once more, a sign of hyperdynamic circulation of aortic regurgitation. This is a very important question, doctor. If you happen to check the BP in the lower limb versus upper limb, right, the systolic pressure in the legs will be 60 millimeters mercury higher than that of the systolic BP in the arms. If it is 170, that will be 230. If it is 140, it will be 200. Systolic BP. Right? Then don't say, what sir, BP is only seen for upper limb, not for lower limb. I too was thinking like that until MD. So, when my prof was tying the cuff and showing, today I am going to demonstrate you guys about hill sign. So then I understood, oh, BP cuff even to the lower limb. So no problem. So why is this important? It is one of the important markers of a severe AR. There are few important clinical features which say whether the AR is a mild one, moderate one, severe one. Clinically only you can say. If hill sign is found, it is a severe form of AR but not a mild form of AR. If it is a mild AR, then you don't find hill sign. That's the point to be carried home. Then, this is one list I hate to remember as an undergraduate. These are all the signs of hyperdynamic circulation.
But remembering these names is the biggest deal. Corrigan's pulse, where there is a rapid upstroke followed by quick collapse, is one important feature. Head bobbing with each heartbeat is a feature of Demoset sign. Then pistol shot sounds which you hear on the femoral arteries in both systole and diastole is called TROP sign. Then systolic pulsations, if you examine the uvula, is called as Muller sign. U for uvula, U for Muller. Then systolic murmur over the femoral artery when compressed proximally and diastolic murmur when compressed distally is basically called Dudosius sign. And Quinkies is, you typically look at the lunula of the nail bed. There you will find capillary pulsations. Unless you have one typical case of a severe form of AR, you don't appreciate all these things. But for entrance and for exam, you have to anyway remember. Hills already we discussed. And Becker's is presence of any arterial pulsations if you do fundoscopy in the retinal artery is typically called Becker's sign. So Quinkies is typically in the fingers. After this is over, there is in orthotics lot of things. Chadwick sign, Jacomer sign. Life is full of too many signs. And then radiology, there are a lot of eponymous named signs. These fellows don't have any other work. If they straight away say intra-articular fracture, it is easy. Why do they need to say Jones fracture, Bennett's fracture? All these names make, I don't know, life easier or miserable. So, that is very important. So, yeah, we'll finish this thing. So, already we finished demosets. So, we'll continue with how do you diagnose. Very important, Dr. Aortic regurgitation, murmur. With every new murmur, don't forget old murmurs. Where will you feel MDM, Prasad? If you don't, if you tell wrong, I am emotionally blackmailing you. I will jump from the top floor. Where? That's right. Where in the apex will you see? I mean, will you see in the apex? Will you see here? Will you see there? Will you see here? Will you see here? Where? It's a localized murmur at the apex, so you need to feel the cardiac impulse. Beautiful. Where will you see aortic stenosis murmur? See, no. Here. Paris, no, in the aortic area, which is right second intercostal, OB, clear high carotid curve, this thing. Where will you see the, now we are talking about what? And pansystolic murmur? Anyway, towards apex, towards axilla, radiating. Now doctor, if you look at aortic regurgitation, you will listen it in neo-aortic area, like old England, new England, aortic area, but neo-aortic area is on the left side, third or fourth intercostal space, right? Then what kind of murmur is a aortic regurgitation murmur? Once more tell me, mid-diastolic crumble of the MS is a high amplitude or a low amplitude murmur? Prasad, quickly. Very good. And pan-systolic murmur of the MR is a high amplitude or low amplitude? Low amplitude and high pitched. And aortic stenosis murmur is a medium pitched. Medium pitched. Then if you look at the aortic regurgitation murmur, pitch is important. Shruti is what you need to be sure about. The shruti of the aortic regurgitation murmur, typically it has got a very low amplitude and a very high pitch, right? So you have a high pitched murmur. Then one more thing, the murmur of the aortic regurgitation will be similar to the lung sounds. That's the reason what you need to tell the patient, hold your breath sir, let me know whether the sound I am listening is your lung sound or the murmur. And how will it be? It is a early diastolic murmur. How will you remember it is a diastolic murmur? Obviously, no. Ventricle pumped blood into aorta systole over. then it is undergoing relaxation and diastole, that time this regurgitation is happening from the aorta. Early diastolic murmur. Right? So between S1, S2 do you listen it, or S2, S1 do you listen it? Between? When is called, when do you call diastole? S2 and S1. Right? So, left dub me, which is S2, which is S1? Lub S1, dub is S2. So, how will you resonate? Lub dub. Lub dub. Like, you make a, what you call, exhalation sound. Like you exhale the air. Lub dub. But it is very secret. So, if you don't listen that ha after the labdab, you lost it. And who prevents you from hearing it? Lung sounds. So, you should ask the patient to hold his lung sounds. And you want to make him to lie down and you want to listen it, or you want to make him sit, lean forward and listen it. Ask him to sit, lean forward. Right? Lean forward. Because it is like a whispering. Whispering breath sound, kind of a sound. Labdab. So that is what you need to basically listen in the neo-aortic area, is what need to be remembered. And it is accentuated by leaning forward. Then between S3, S4, what do you expect to listen if there is an aortic regurgitation? Aurek Musibat. Ah, below. S3, beautiful. Because aortic regurgitation lead to LV dilatation, LV failure, and that lead to development of S3. Aortic stenosis lead to S4 is what need to be remembered. Then a very important murmur in case of the aortic regurgitation is called Austin Finch murmur. What is this murmur? Very simple. Regurgitation ka jet kaise maar rahe bide? Piche maar rahe? Like a if you start the vehicle, you will get that fume, no? You go to Mehdipatnam or Sheikh Pet, you will have full fume releasing vehicle, high sound may, in all directions he will be driving. Suddenly if European comes to India, they will say, "Are, what a beautiful traffic here, serpentine traffic." Huh? So, like a serpent, unless you go, you can't cross Mehdipatnam crossroads. So, you have a regurgitant blood. When is it occurring? When the left ventricle is undergoing diastolic. Matlab, left ventricle is supposed to release, get the release from the blood is expected to come from left atrium. Right, doctor? So, left atrium is trying to push the blood. Left ventricle is also getting a regurgitant from aortic valve. Then what will happen? Two swords cannot sit in the same knife. Right? Left ventricle, like a newly married son-in-law, has gone to father-in-law's house to participate in the consummation of marriage program. But the father-in-law is such a loud fellow that in the next room he is shouting at the mother-in-law. Like aortic regurgitation jet. So, can the left ventricle son-in-law can embrace the daughter-in-law and the newly married bride and can finish the consummation? No. This regurgitant jet will be interfering with this left atrial blood which is coming. Right? Generally, this kind of interference of the forward flowing blood from the left atrium into left ventricle, where do you see? If you have a mitral stenosis. Mitral stenosis hai to bhi same problem hai na doctor. Magar waha kya hai? Sachmuch problem hai. Right? But here, this impedance to the flow from left atrium to left ventricle is because of the aortic regurgitation jet, which is causing turbulence and impeding this forward flow. Right, doctor? So, any impedance to the blood flow will lead to murmur, and that murmur is called
Austin Finch murmur is what need to be remembered. Just like mitral stenosis lead to a mid-diastolic murmur, even this is also a mid-diastolic murmur. Just like Austin Flint murmur is a, then examiner will ask a question. Doctor, is it aortic regurgitation MDM or is it DA? Mitral stenosis MDM is what he will ask. Right, doctor? But what is the specialty of our MDM of the mitral stenosis we already discussed? Before the next systole, end of the diastole, due to atrial contraction, it will undergo accentuation. What is that called? Pre-systolic accentuation. If it is a MDM because of the MS, but if it is a Austin Flint murmur, there is no such pre-systolic accentuation. But that is not a complete proof. Why? Can there be a MDM of the MS without pre-systolic accentuation? Already we discussed. Can there be loss of pre-systolic accentuation in case of MDM of MS? Yes, sir. When? If the MS is severe and if there is a left atrial enlargement with atrial fibrillation, a shivering atrium cannot contract in the end of the diastole. So there is no pre-systolic accentuation. Then what will examiner will tell you? Array, how can you say that absence of pre-systolic accentuation can be a proof of aortic regurgitation but not MS? Then what will you tell? Sir, irregular pulse is there, sir, please check. He is not there. If atrial fibrillation would have killed the pre-systolic accentuation of the MDM of the MS, there should be irregular pulse. Magar patient ka pulse, kaise aortic regurgitation mein? Bounding pulse is what is there, sir. How can you say that it is MS? Right? So ultimately, case presentation should be like a fighting. You should fight your case, prove and then snatch your degree. That should be the spirit with which you need to go to exam. And that confidence you will get if you see, 5 patients of MS and 5 patients of AR, let me tell you. You don't need more also for that. Okay, doctor? So that is very, very important. So it is a low pitch diastolic rumble. Austin Flint, how will you describe? And it is due to? One more important question. Agar mild or moderate AR hypo, can you listen Austin Flint? No, sir. Austin Flint is a sign of a severe AR. Is just like Hill sign is a sign of severe AR. Clinically, is what you need to ultimately remember, doctor. So, widened pulse pressure, a high pitched blowing early diastolic murmur, high pitched blowing quality, like a, I said, no, lubbed up kind of a quality. Then it is a decrescendo murmur. It is only during the early part of the diastole. That's what you need to basically appreciate. Then any regurgitation or any valvular condition, what did we study? Acute AR or chronic AR are the two kinds of presentation. Acute AR mein kya hota? Left ventricle is not prepared for the regurgitation. Right? So, what happens to the LVADP, left ventricular end diastolic pressure? It shoots from normal 10 into 50. Whereas, if it is a chronic AR, how will you recognize? LV become dilated enough that it will accommodate the pressure, and typically the pressure will be only around 12. If it is severe at most, it will then go to 25. Only after the LV completely failed. Right, doctor? That's the difference between what is the parameter that differentiates acute from chronic MR, chronic AR. On 2D echo, LVADP is an important marker. If the LVADP is 50, then it is an acute AR. LVADP is between 12 to 25, then it is more of a chronic AR, is what you need to appreciate. So typically patient will have hyperdynamic circulation, and how is the apex? Down and laterally displaced because of the enlargement of the left ventricle is what you need to remember. If you look at ECG, LV appears to be hypertrophied and dilated. Echo can
be able to quantify that regurgitation. And this is another example of a dilated heart in case of an aortic regurgitation. And you will do a little rangoli when you do 2D echo color Doppler and identify and quantify the degree of the regurgitant jet and quantify the severity of the AR is what need to be remembered. So doctor, this is very very important. The regurgitant jet is there, no? When you do color Doppler echo, then the rate at which this jet will decline, the slope of this jet is an important indicator of the severity. If this decline is sharper, then it is a more severe AR is how the echo will help you to grade. So how will you treat, doctor? Treat the LVF. Mainly it is the treatment of left ventricular failure. Already we finished congestive heart failure treatment day before yesterday. Severe cases you will do valve replacement, which is the only definitive treatment. Is AR is an indication for giving endocarditis prophylaxis? Definitely. AR and AR is not TR. TR is trivial. AR is severe. So you need to give endocarditis prophylaxis. That is the basic gyan, doctor. So few quick clinical pearls to summarize. Other than AR, where else do you see wide pulse pressure? Is a very common MCQ in the exam, doctor. Aortic regurgitation, hyperthyroidism, anemia, bed beriberi, hypertension and hypertrophic subaortic stenosis, in all these scenarios you can have a wide pulse pressure, which is a marker of a hyperdynamic circulation is what need to be remembered. So how do you differentiate acute from chronic AR? What is the most important marker? Plain radiograph may dilatation. And if you do the echo, left ventricular end diastolic pressure. If it is 50, it is acute. If it is 12 to 25, it is chronic. Very good. Then already you remember the murmurs. Mid diastolic rumble with a presystolic accentuation with an opening snap is equal to MS. MR is basically what, doctor? A pansystolic murmur. No S1 heard, no S2 heard, only murmur is heard, which is a high pitched one. Zzz is what you listen. MBP classically is associated with a mid-systolic click. After this we will discuss MBP, right? A mid-systolic click. Hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, what do you typically see, doctor? A systolic murmur. It is also responsible for systolic murmur. Then PDA may, patent ductus arteriosus may, both systole and diastole it will expand. And hence, it is an example of a continuous machinery murmur. Yes, what you need to remember. And ASD may already be discussed, fixed split of the S2. That means S2 is split. In fact, it is increased split. Between A2, P2, there is a increased distance. But with inspiration, it is not further increased. Increase jo hai, it remains wide only, but it won't become wider at the time of inspiration. Normally second hand zone split, what will be during inspiration? There is an increased venous return into the right side of the heart. Right side of the heart. You agree with that? Negative intrathoracic pressure sucks the blood into right side of the heart. All that sucked blood will enter into right atrium. That goes to right ventricle. So that increased venous return during inspiration, what will it do? That will delay the P2. Hence A2 P2 distance become wider every time there is inspiration. Right? Why in ASD, first of all, there is a wide second heart zone split? Because ASD is causing left atrium into right atrium shunting of the blood. So right atrium is receiving the regular venous return. Additionally, it is receiving the left atrial blood, that increased blood across the pulmonic valve. From right atrium, it will go to right ventricle to pulmonic valve into pulmonary artery, no? So that increased blood flow across pulmonic valve will lead to P2 getting delayed. So A2 P2 distance will increase. Right? But when inspiration occur, when more venous return want to come into the right atrium, what will right atrium will tell? Ye kya karenge baba, already left atrium has thrown blood into me. टू द शंट, ऊपर से तुम भी इंस्पिरेशन कर रहे हो बोल के ज्यादा ब्लड लाने के लिए कोशिश कर रहे। बाइबल रिसीव, आई विल नॉट रिसीव एनी मोर फर्दर कोटा ऑफ ब्लड, इट विल टेल बिकॉज राइट एट्रियल प्रेशर इज ऑलरेडी हाई ड्यू टू द एक्स्ट्रा ब्लड व्हिच एंटर्ड फ्रॉम द लेफ्ट एट्रियम। व्हेन द प्रेशर इज हाई वेन्स कांट ड्रेन एक्स्ट्रा ड्यूरिंग इंस्पिरेशन, सो फर्दर widening of the split doesn't occur at the time of inspiration. Whatever the widening occur, that remains the same widening both inspiration and expiration. Hence it is called fixed widened split is the hallmark of ASD is what need to be remembered. Then BSD is what kind of murmur? Once more, left ventricular blood is gushed into right ventricle across the VSD, hence parasternally you will listen the systolic murmur of the VSD is what need to be remembered. Aortic regurgitation already you are sure. There is a decrescent mid diastolic murmur is a classical feature. Rather it should be called early diastolic murmur, high pitched, one which is decrescent. Aortic stenosis pulses set at this already we have discussed. Now doctor, with all this gyan, before we conclude, $1 million question that remains answered, to be answered is, will afterload reduction is beneficial or not in case of AR? Good for AR. In AR, if you peripheral vascular dilatation is there, then when the peripheral resistance diminishes, regurgitation that will diminish. Hence in pregnancy what happens? AR improves or worsens? Improves, because in pregnancy high progesterone will cause the relaxation of the peripheral vascular smooth muscle. Yes, is it good or bad to put vasodilators? Don't put vasodilators if it is AS. That is the fundamental difference between the two. You have to recognize and understand how to treat. So when will you may put the patient to vasodilator if he is having AR? When will it be beneficial? If the LV is dilated, you have to take a decision whether ACE inhibitor, which is a vasodilator, shall be introduced in this patient of AR or not. Then what will you do? You will post the patient for echo. When you post the patient for echo, you will look for the LV at the end of the diastole. How much is the LV diameter? If the aortic regurgitation is severe, what happened to the LV? Left atrium se blood aaya aur AR ke wajah se this is a regurgitant blend, together will fill the LV. So increase the LV and the diastolic diameter will be there, which is a marker of the severity of AR. If the LV and you here, this is the LV doctor, LV and diastolic diameter, if it is more than 5 centimeters, then LV is dilated, then you need to start ACE inhibitors. And suppose if the systolic BP elevates, that is also another important indication for afterload reduction, right doctor? Why? Systolic BP ek taraf se LV ko fail karega, AR also is going to fail the LV, so we don't let the systolic BP to fail the LV, hence we have to control the hypertension adequately. Hence, we need to introduce afterload reducing agent like vasodilator, like ACE inhibitor is what need to be remembered. So, when is surgery indicated is an important question. If there are symptoms, if the ejection fraction is less than 55%, that means LV failed. Now, tell me once more. Aortic regurgitation may generally, if the LV didn't fail, will EF will be high or low? High, because LV is trying to push the regular venous return and also the regurgitant blood. But instead of a high EF, you see any echo report of a AR patient, right doctor? EF you expect it to be 80%, 78%, but patient should not be very happy man. Or you see doctor, normal people may 55-60%, in me it is 75-80% EF. Sir, all that excess EF is because of regurgitation, regular venous return, dononko your heart is pumping out. That is the reason. If the EF falls less than 55%,
right? Or if the LV end systolic dimension, what is the importance of LV end systolic dimension? If the LV failed, already we discussed, you know, LV failure, how will you identify on 2D echo? At the end of the systole, you expect its diameter to be smaller. If it is more than 5, that means the LV failed. LV end diastolic pressure is a marker of, end diastolic diameter is a marker of degree of regurgitation. Right? So, that is what you need to fundamentally appreciate, doctor. So, that is all the story which is called aortic regurgitation.